To our special guest tonight, Bart Van Ark, Executive Vice President and Chief Economist at the Conference Board, joins me right here in the Mumbai studio. Welcome to India, Bart.
Thank you for being here, Monica.
I know we want to start talking about the leading economic index that the Conference Board has developed for India,
right.
And it doesn't paint a very pretty picture for India. But before I get to that, let's talk a little bit about what's going on in the U.S. We're seeing this political turmoil.
Right.
It reminds us of 2011.
Right.
Now, in 2011, it did royal markets. We did see a credit rating cut. What do you think this time is going to bring us?
Yeah, I mean, as you said, I mean, today's news was actually altogether reasonably positive. The second quarter holding up reasonably well.
Mm-hmm.
Also, we had a little bit of an uptick in the first quarter, which was actually a weak quarter. That was upgraded to 1.1. So that was all kind of okay. Then these unemployment claims that you mentioned, I think that's also good news for the labor market. But we really need to look forward. And there's still some real threats in the economy itself. First of all, there is the labor market, as you mentioned. I mean, unemployment remains very high. Unemployment came down last month, but it comes down for the wrong reasons. I mean, labor force participation is declining in the United States, so
yes.
We need to add more jobs rather than see people leaving the labor force. So that's a major concern in going forward. Luckily, we had this number today. But then there are some other threats. Investment doesn't look really very promising in going forward. It picked up a little bit in the number that we got today for the second quarter, but in looking forward, it's still way too weak. Profits actually have been downwardly adjusted, probably by about $10 billion, so that isn't going to paint a very nice picture. And then, of course, we have exports. Even though exports is not such a big part of the U.S. economy, with this weak global economy, including India, which we'll talk about in a minute,
yeah.
That's not going to look promising. And then, as you say, down the line, there is the politics of all this. So we're going
it's
back
not down the line,
into
but it's
this.
Right, yes.
It may actually start tomorrow.
Yeah.
So the government shutdown is one thing that might potentially happen. The bigger worry, in my view, is the debt ceiling debate. If we get into debt, that indeed in 2011 created a huge uproar, and hopefully that will not happen again, because that could really push down growth. But still, I mean, even without that, this fourth quarter will probably show us about a 2% growth rate, so it will be much less than the 2.5% growth rate. And even in the final part of the year, without all this trouble, I don't think the U.S. economy will grow much faster than 2.5%.
Okay, so 2.5% is what you're looking at for 2019?
For the final part of
the
year.
Yeah.
For the year as a whole, given the weakness in the beginning of the year, we would drop below 2%, yeah.
Below 2%.
Yeah, for the year as a whole.
All right,
yeah.
So every time we've hit on a government spending situation in the U.S., and we've hit upon it fairly frequently in the last 2 years. 2011, we ran through something pretty similar. Then we had the fiscal cliff last year.
Sequester.
We had the sequester early this year. And it sort of creates panic for a bit, but then we manage to get past it. My question is, this time round, we're experiencing this at a time when we know that the Federal Reserve is going to start pulling back,
right.
Whether it pulls back in October, November, December,
right.
Or early next year.
Right.
So that confidence of unlimited liquidity
right.
isn't there in this market.
Right.
What kind of double whammy impact could this have?
Well, I think, first of all, I think the surprise, at least to some, the surprise that the tapering didn't happen in September, I think actually sent a sign to the markets that the Fed will only do this if they really see an improvement in the economy.
Right.
We were not so surprised ourselves at the Conference Board, because the economy wasn't really that strong. So in the end, we thought, well, this was the right decision for the Fed to take. Now, of course, the Fed basically said, if the economy shows strengthening, then we may do that. So don't be surprised that if the economy is going to accelerate to 2.5% or more in the fourth quarter, it's going to happen. But if it remains as weak as it is, then I think we're very likely to see the tapering further delayed, probably well into next year. The other thing that is very important to keep in mind is that there is a change of mindset in the United States. You know, we talk about recovery, but it's really hard these days, 5 years after this financial crisis started, to speak about recovery. We're really now talking about why is it that the U.S. economy is growing so slowly. And really, the Fed cannot have this quantitative easing going on forever just
despite
to prop up the economy.
$2 trillion of cash injection into the economy, you're disappointed with growth. Imagine what happens if the Fed starts pulling back and you have this political overhang.
Right.
So the question I'm asking is, are we headed into more uncertain times when it comes to the fundamental economy in the U.S. and therefore, by extension, the markets as well?
Yeah, so the question I think really is, what signals, how will the Federal Reserve find the exit? But they will look for an exit out of this quantitative easing. It cannot go on forever.
Right.
But at the same time, I think they're very cautious not to do this at a time that the effects on the economy will be very negative. So that's why I would say, you know, let's keep watching the real economy in the United States, because that's to a large extent determining their numbers, including the labor market, by the way. period. It's very important.
Fair enough. So you're expecting realistically the taper to start next year, given what the conditions look like right now from the economic fundamentals point of view, including the Fed's alluded to this as well, the fiscal issues, right? The government issues, they've alluded to this. So given what we're going through right now, you think maybe it'll be the end of this year or next year?
If the economy in the final part of the year would indeed score about 2.5%, as we have in our forecast at the conference board, then you know it might very well be that in December or so we could see that tapering beginning to happen. But mind you, it's tapering. I mean, we're putting $85 billion in treasuries every month. Mm-hmm. Now, it may become 75 or it may become 65. We're still having quantitative easing. We're still supporting the locating the economy. The reaction globally, including in India, I mean, has been, I think, huge compared to what the real effect of this tapering is going to be. It's really more a change of mindset rather than anything else.
So you think we've over-factored in the impact of a taper?
Oh, yes. And you could see that because the markets had factored some of the tapering in. When it then didn't happen, we saw a quick rally.
Yes, absolutely. Including in emerging markets and emerging market currencies.
So we're overreacting to this point. I mean, they are looking for the exit, but they're all doing it very carefully because they cannot afford at this moment the economy to slow even further in the United States than already is.
What's your view on interest rates in the U.S. and the dollar? So the 10-year's come off now. It's about 2.6%, but it's still substantially higher than where it was before May 22nd when Mr. Bernanke spoke, you know, so we're about 70, 80 basis points higher from there. Do you think this is whether it's going to settle or do you see it spiking back to the 3% levels? Because that, in a sense, has correlation to fund movement across the world.
So if our projections would be right, that we're seeing this kind of 2.5, maybe next year a little more in terms of growth, the economy is still trying to sort of, you know, gain more ground, then I would expect that the long-term interest rates, which have already been going up for a while, will continue to rise, which will have a positive impact on the dollar. We also see mortgage rates going up. You mentioned that earlier. I mean, one of the reasons why this is leveling off a little is just that mortgage rates are beginning to go up quite substantially. Still, there's quite a bit of room, but I don't think... So the long-term interest rates will increase. The base rates, I think, you know, the Federal Reserve will remain very, very careful before they're going to kill off that
kind of growth. They've stressed on that again and again, that a rate hike is very, very far
down the line, and we would have to see significant improvements in growth compared to what we currently have.
All right, fair enough. Where in the global economy are you seeing spots of strength? We're now finally talking about money or capital returning to Europe, given that we've seen some turnaround in the GDP growth figures and indications that Europe is finally coming out of a recession. Do you see Europe moving from strength to strength, and what's your view on emerging markets?
Yeah, well, first of all, on Europe, actually today we also released our monthly euro area leading economic index, which actually for, I think, the fourth month in a row showed a pretty strong improvement.
Ah, great.
So that's good news, but just keep in mind where they're coming from, right? I mean, they're coming out of a pretty bad recession.
Sure.
We've been in a recession, you know, some countries have been in a recession for close to 2 years. We're just moving into positive territory. So we're now just, you know, at the end of the year, we may just be growing the economy rather than contracting the economy. For the year as a whole, again, over last year, the euro area will still contract. Going into next year, we may begin to see some improvement. But Europe is a very different place than the United States. You don't see this kind of, you know, very volatile sudden recoveries. It will be a very slow process. And on the background, there is still, of course, the financial stability issue. It's relatively stable now, but not all problems have been solved. We still don't have a banking union. We still don't have a good oversight system. So there is a lot of work to be done in Europe. So I wouldn't count on too much firepower coming from Europe. Now, then going to the emerging markets, China is hanging in reasonably okay. Could have been worse. But, you know, at the conference board, we have been projecting this kind of longer-term slowdown of the Chinese economy because of the transition from an investment export-driven economy to a consumer-driven. Yeah. And, you know, that will just slow growth almost by definition. So we think that slowing growth is going to continue. Let's just hope that we do not have more of these big incidents as we had it back in June.
They're trying very hard to balance the economy at that 7.5% mark, right? So we keep seeing that happen. It slows off, and then, you know, and then you'll see a whole slew of measures come in that might help boost growth a little bit, and then they're worried about overheating, and so then it slows off. We've seen this happen for at least a year and a half, two now in China.
Yeah, but on the other hand, the government is preparing themselves and the Chinese population for the fact that growth will slow. So they have made clear that we need to prepare ourselves for this. You know, the signal that the PBOC, the People's Bank of China, sent out back in June, you know, whether it was carefully or smartly done or not is another discussion, but it did send a signal that they're willing to intervene, that they don't want this economy to overheat again. So if anything, China will hopefully gradually slow and not rapidly slow down. Now, Southeast Asia, I think that's a bit of a bright spot, even though Indonesia, of course, is having a hard time too at the moment. But some of the economies there and also the ASEAN integration will help to speed that economy or these economies up a bit. India, we'll talk about in a minute.
Right now, in fact.
Right now, we don't want to talk about Latin America.
Before I run out of time and we don't spend enough time on our leading economic index, it doesn't show a very good picture for India. No. It declined in the month of August. It decreased 1.6%. Three of the eight components underlying that index contributed positively to the index. So five contributed negatively to the index. Key areas that show improvement, bank credit and exports, capital goods have declined. Give me a big picture view of India based on what your index is telling you.
Well, we have to really go back in history because we have a history of this index. So we can really go back actually to 1990. But if we look at the last few years, we actually have seen the Indian leading economic index in weak territory for quite a while, basically since 2011, a little bit of an uptick at the end of 2012, but it's been weak. What we've seen over the last 3-4 months, it has been coming down very rapidly. And of course, some of that is related to the monetary, the tapering back and the fears of tapering back that we've been talking about. But essentially what I think that has done is that it has exposed some of the structural flaws that the Indian economy is facing. And I think we're beginning to see that that reflected. Industrial production is adding significantly to the downturn here in the leading economic index. So that is a clear sign. Business sentiment and services is coming down. Of course,
the
yield spread,
You said it's been coming down for the last 3 or 4 months. This is the leading economic index. That means that we're in for several more months of pain because you're not seeing any turnaround in this index.
Yeah, so importantly, the leading economic index is sending some signals about what may happen to the economy 3-4 months ahead. So
it means this index says this slowdown is here to stay for at least the next 3-4 months.
The economy is very unlikely to accelerate over the next 3-4 months. And if you look at the depth of the index that we're currently looking at, it's very likely to slow down a little more.
Are you seeing any bright spots at all when you look at India?
Well, it's just interesting to see the exports, and of course some of it is related to the weakening of the rupee, and that helps. But the problem, of course, is that exports could be much bigger in India than it really is because of the weakness of the manufacturing sector. If we just had a larger manufacturing sector in India, we would benefit from it significantly more. The bank credit part does, of course, help, but there are actually small things compared to the bigger declines that we have seen in some of the other indicators. You know, It's really a bit of a perfect storm that comes over India. I mean, on the one hand, so you got this tapering effect. It has really exposed some of the structural flaws in the economy. And then what we talked about is this slow global economy. And all of this comes together here. And that's not giving us very good news. And also the pain has been sort of extended over time. So it takes we're already in this for a while. And it will probably take a little longer. So we need to have some...
Do you have any horizon? Could it be 6, 3, 4 months? Does the index tell you when this could turn? Does it change?
No, it doesn't. At this moment to tell us when it will turn. Of course it will turn, but
will it be 3, 6 months, a year? We're going to elections in a few months from now, so you know, everybody's keen to know what impact that will have on the economy. So I'm just wondering if there are any green shoots in that index.
Yeah, well, you cannot expect huge policy corrections in the next couple of months, and some of these policy corrections are big. Taxes, reforms, labor market reforms, they're not going to happen anytime soon, so that is not very promising. Also, we need to look really further out, and that is also, you know, the Indian economy has potential to grow faster, but whether it really can go back to the 7-8% growth rate that we had, in the 2000s, I think that's highly questionable.
All right, Bart, we appreciate you finding the time to join us here
in
the studio.
And I hope we'll have some better news next time.
I hope so as well. It's lovely to speak to you face-to-face as opposed to disembodied on several satellite lines. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your trip to India. Thank you very much for joining us.
You're welcome.
That's Bart Von Ark, the chief economist at the Conference Board. With that, we're going